This evening on The Rock Newman Show, why is there such a lack of black professors on American college campuses? It's a question that both Leslie T. Fenwick, Dean of the Howard School of Education, and H. Patrick Swygert, President Emeritus at Howard University, pose, and a problem they say is hurting black college students nationwide. That's coming up on the next Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. In the last month, we've seen an explosion of protests on college campuses across the country in support of black and minority students being treated fairly. I'm excited to talk about campus diversity with the authors of the recent Washington Post article entitled, It's 2015. Where are all the black college faculty? Good evening, folks. Did I ever tell you that I love Howard University and just about everything about it? Well, I'd like to welcome this evening Dr. Leslie Fenwick, Dean of Howard University's School of Education, and Mr. H. Patrick Swygert, President Emeritus here at Howard and at State University of New York at Albany. It's my pleasure to have both of you.
Thank
you so much for joining us. You guys authored a piece in the Washington Post that I referenced in the opening here, Where's All the Black Faculty? In that piece, you suggest that black students throughout this country are being negatively impacted, are being hurt by a lack of black professors and blacks in leadership positions at white institutions. How is it hurting them?
Absolutely. One of the things we were concerned about is that the media was casting the students' legitimate and righteous concerns as a First Amendment issue, as a free speech issue. Mm-hmm. When in fact, the issues that the students were raising are serious issues that in 65 and 75 and 85 we dealt with, and now unfortunately this new generation is dealing with as well. We believe that the nation's colleges and universities need to be called to task on the representativeness of their faculty. There should be, all students benefit from diverse models of intellectual authority. It's powerful when you go to Howard University or Hampton University and you walk into a classroom mm-hmm. and there's a Ghanaian female teaching English literature, and you go next door and into a mathematics classroom being taught by an African-American male. Mm-hmm. And then you go across the way to a foreign language course being taught by an Hispanic male. This kind of diversity is important for students. It tells them that all people contribute to intellectual knowledge and the generation of knowledge, the mm-hmm. intellectual activity of a university.
And the inverse of that is, when a black, particularly when a black student is on a white campus, there is a reinforcement of a negative stereotype that where these black students don't see people that look like them in academic authority, in higher levels at these institutions. And what does that do for the image of that child?
Well, we all know that there are lots of ways to characterize teaching. Yeah. There's classroom teaching, and then there's the teaching that comes about when you mimic who you see. That's mm-hmm. teaching as well. Mm-hmm. And when you don't see persons in the positions of authority and intellectual leadership, what message does that send? That's a negative message. And we find that in campuses throughout the country, and let me just make one quick aside. Like you, I'm also a Howard graduate.
Yeah.
So in a sense, I won't say we're spoiled, uh-huh. but in a sense, we've been the beneficiary
sure.
of the kind of intellectual leadership that at Howard we've just taken, if you will, for granted. That's uh-huh. been our world. Uh-huh. But that's not the world of the majority of African-American youngsters in college today. The majority in college today are attending historically white institutions. Uh-huh. And so we have to focus as well, not simply on our HBCUs,
yes.
which of course we continue to do, mm-hmm. but on these other institutions as well, because that's where the majority of our students reside. Mm-hmm. And there is this intellectual and, if you will, leadership vacuum mm-hmm. on far too many campuses. Mm-hmm. When you consider that some of the major campuses in this country, major in terms of reputation, major in terms of population, have less than 2%, right. 3% right. African American presence, yeah. there's something wrong with that picture. And the kids know that, the students know that.
When I looked at some of your research, which points out that a college down in Alabama has the highest percentage, I think it was like 6.8, mm-hmm. which still doesn't mm-hmm. approach, you know, the population mm-hmm. of blacks in this country. And, you know, esteemed programs in the Ivy League and in the North are hovering mm-hmm. around 3%. The mm-hmm. the overall percentage across the country is 4%. Mm-hmm. That is a problem. I want to come back to something that you said, which I think is a very interesting subtlety or nuance, in that the Black Lives Movement, mm-hmm. the protest, if you will, and not so much Black Lives Movement, but on college, you're saying that it was characterized as only a First Amendment issue. And what you're talking about is something very critical that I think mass media has really missed or ignored.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, we look at these institutions, the institutions where the students have been leading this effort.
Yeah.
These are well-endowed state and private institutions. Mm-hmm. Okay. All of these institutions have vice presidents for diversity. All of these institutions, if you go to their websites, have diversity plans. But it took the student movement to say that we can't suffice on written words and spoken words. Mm-hmm. We need some real benchmarks of achievement here.
Yeah.
And that's what prompted us to look at the statistics on black faculty, because oftentimes those statistics are hidden behind the language of historically underrepresented groups, mm-hmm. where you can lump lots of different folk into that category and still not make the advances around the representativeness of black faculty. Mm-hmm. We've doubled the production of black PhDs over the last 10 years.
Yeah.
Really more than doubled, increased it by 42%. Mm-hmm. And yet we still see that the traditionally white institutions have not made sufficient headway, and they're admitting that now mm-hmm. In the recruitment, retention, and promotion of black faculty. And this is the interesting thing. Where there are no black faculty, there are no black department chairs,
yeah.
there are no black deans, mm-hmm. and we know that less than about 30 of the country's 3,000 universities are led by African Americans. This isn't acceptable in a new millennium. We are two decades into a new millennium,
yeah.
and still kind of repeating this narrative mm-hmm. that haunted us in mm-hmm. the 50s and 60s.
Mm-hmm.
We should have let go by now of the narrative around dual systems of education, but we see that we're still in some ways mm-hmm. fighting brown.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't done sufficient work in integrating student populations, and we've almost done no work in creating space for black intellectuals to be yeah. at traditionally white institutions.
Are you guys at all familiar with a gentleman, I think his name is Craig Wilder, who has a book, I don't know if it's Ebony and Ivy, but what he talks about is the impact and how these schools in the North and South, but mm-hmm. he focused in part on Ivy League schools, the impact that slavery had on these institutions becoming the great quote-unquote successes that they have become.
Yeah,
and when you juxtapose, when you juxtapose that they grew into prominence off of the backs of free labor, mm-hmm. and yet today they continue not to practice anything remotely close to what one would call fair hiring practices. Mm-hmm. Because it is frankly, it is unfair, and it is not only the black student that is impacted by not having a richer, diverse experience, it's the white student also.
Yeah, he speaks to the historical truths that many New Englanders profited mightily from the Middle Passage. They profited through the triangle of trade, slaves, sugar, cotton, and money, mm-hmm. finally money, mm-hmm. that came to rest in the hands of New England importers, New England bankers, New England entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. Slavery at its root, if you will. Mm-hmm. Some of the institutions that are examined, their founders were direct beneficiaries of that middle passage.
Yes.
And the tragedy that middle passage represents and mm-hmm. represented. Mm-hmm. A number of institutions, Brown and a number of other institutions, have sought to, in a sense, self-examine that history.
Right.
But there are institutions that have, as Dr. Fenwick mentioned a moment ago, enormous resources. Mm-hmm. I'll give you an example. There's one institution in the United States, very well known, that has at last report, a $32 billion endowment. Yeah. That's billion with a B,
yeah.
endowment.
Yeah.
But with $32 billion, what can't you do?
Yeah.
If you're serious,
yeah.
really, what can't you do?
Right.
In terms of recruiting talented faculty, mm-hmm. And recruiting talented youngsters, and giving them support that they may need. Mm-hmm. So when an institution like that says, we're gonna go into communities, and we're gonna take the top 1% of graduates of a Ballou High School.
Yeah.
Well, that's great. It's better than no percent, mm-hmm. but they've got $32 billion to work with.
Yeah.
You can recast Ballou High School if you were so inclined
sure.
to do so.
Sure.
The same with faculty.
Yeah.
It's very difficult for institutions, as you well know, to self-examine, particularly to self-examine when the history is not terribly attractive.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of these mm-hmm. institutions were founded, quite candidly, on the backs, and as a result, of black slavery.
Yeah.
I mean, that is just yeah. a historical fact.
Yeah.
It's very difficult, very painful.
Mm-hmm.
There's another institution that, very close by, relatively speaking, that is known as Mr. Jefferson's University,
yeah.
University of Virginia.
Yes.
Well, unlike George Washington, Mr. Jefferson, when he passed, he did not free his slaves,
yeah.
quite the contrary.
Right.
He did employ slave labor on his plantation, as mm-hmm. most did, mm-hmm. but he also employed black youngsters, children, mm-hmm. in his nails factory mm-hmm. on his plantation. Well, when you go to University of Virginia, he's still celebrated, and perhaps he should for his intellect,
right.
For his work with the Declaration of Independence. Right. Perhaps he should be, but we should also acknowledge the roots of the institution, mm-hmm. and indeed the moral obligation and responsibility that continues to this day. Again, as Dr. Fenwick mentioned, Brown is not over.
Yeah.
You know, Brown mm-hmm. Brown 1954 is not
over. Let me just say this, because recently I saw a video clip of James Baldwin,
mm. mm-hmm.
and he must have been the early 60s when he was speaking.
A frequent visitor to this campus, to
yes,
Howard.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And he said, someone was asking him if one of his adversaries was a racist. He says, well, I can't get in his head or can't get in his heart to tell you whether
right.
or not he's a racist. But I know one thing, his policies make it such that I have to attend inferior schools. His policies make it such that I can only live at a certain place. I can't get a bank loan if I'm trying to go into a neighborhood that they don't design for me. And he gave several of those examples which define racism, mm-hmm. and it's not a far leap that if you practice racism, mm-hmm. you might be a racist.
Right.
And so I bring that up as a backdrop to these institutions, these modern institutions today, highly esteemed and recognized, they still are not getting over the yardstick of a policy which could in fact be deemed as practicing racism.
Well, James Baldwin's work, we're familiar with that quote, and his book, of non-fictional essays, The Price of a Ticket,
yeah.
still so relevant around race and equity and access. But one of the things that concerns us is that, you know, Brown was about breaking apart this apartheid system that controlled access to public and private spaces.
Mm-hmm.
We had for generations African-American people paying state taxes,
right.
couldn't go to the University of Virginia,
yeah.
couldn't go to the University of Missouri, paid yeah. state taxes yeah. to support those institutions. Mm-hmm. And I could go on and on. It's not just UVA and Missouri. Mm-hmm. We had 16 states that operated dual education systems. Mm-hmm. And we, in 2015, are still seeing fallout from that. Mm-hmm. We're still seeing that we're fighting Brown. We're not yet there. Mm-hmm. We haven't integrated the student population at these institutions, and we certainly haven't integrated the leadership, the intellectual leadership, the administrative leadership. We should not have a circumstance in the United States where any population of citizens has paid state tax dollars to support institutions and they don't have access to those institutions, either as students or employees of the institutions. Take Missouri.
Yeah.
The African American population is about 11.8%, 12%. Mm-hmm. They say, the U.S. Census says, that about 13% of the United States is African American. Yeah. I think there are more black people than that.
Yeah.
So the populations of African Americans in Missouri and in the United States are comparable.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, less than 5% of the faculty at University of Missouri is African American, and a smaller percentage of students is African American. These are some things that we need to hold not only the university administrators' feet to the fire on, but our state legislators mm-hmm. Need to develop plans to rectify this long-standing inequity.
What has been the reaction that one or both of you have gotten? Because you've hit on a nerve. Frankly speaking, you've hit on a nerve that, as you mentioned earlier, that sort of self-examination is very difficult when you look in the mirror and the history has been very ugly. So mm-hmm. you wrote this and a whole lot of people had reaction to it in the piece that came in the Washington mm-hmm. Post. Those individuals who are at these institutions and lawmakers around the country, what kind of feedback have you all gotten after that piece?
Well, as you probably know, this is my 39th, 40th year in higher education. I know many, many people in higher education around the country. I was at Temple University for 18 years,
yeah.
State University of New York at Albany for 5 years as president.
Mm-hmm.
The reaction that I've received from my colleagues, particularly my presidential colleagues, has been right on. You know, it's about time. And mm-hmm. in fact, that is a problem. Now, the acknowledgement of the problem and then doing something about it is two different things.
Yeah.
Let's go back to Missouri.
Yeah.
I know folk at Missouri who right on agree with you, it's about time someone mm-hmm. made the statement. But how did things come to a real head in Missouri? The football team.
Yeah.
The football team
yeah.
said, we're not going to play.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Convinced the coach, and the coach stood up with his team and said, I agree with my team.
Yeah.
That got the legislature, that got the Board of Regents, mm-hmm. that got the leadership engaged. Mm-hmm. It took the football team.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what do you do where you don't have a football team?
Yeah.
where you don't have that kind of community that's willing to acknowledge and act upon it. Right. And that's the challenge. It's not a question of we don't know. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows the statistics. Everyone knows the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the doing something
yeah.
about it.
Yeah.
And so in my case, the reaction has largely been positive. Of course, you get some folk who say, well, you should be pleased that you got 5%. You should be happy. You know, when in my day, you didn't have any percent.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, well, that's a case of, you know, you should be free. You should be pleased that you're now free. Oh, my people were enslaved.
Yeah.
So,
you know, I just mentioned James Baldwin. Of course, Frederick Douglass says, you know, power concedes nothing without a struggle, never has, never will.
Former Howard trustee.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Oh, I love this university.
Well, you know, I agree with President Emeritus Swigert. The reaction that I've received from my dean peers across the country, because they've read the piece
yeah.
and they email me, has been, you're stating, this is true.
Mm-hmm.
I have not received one email that contests the statistics or the notion that we've got to do better. And mm-hmm. in fact, I was very pleased to receive emails from four members of the National Academy of Education.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the nation's premier associations of right. highly recognized education researchers and scholars. They are at Yale mm-hmm. and Stanford and Michigan, and I'm leaving out an institution right now, but you know, some of the institutions yeah. that are cited in the article.
Yeah.
And they said, absolutely, this is true and we need to do better. The your point about doing better,
mm-hmm.
That's easier to say.
Yeah. than coming up with
the strategy and then putting the money behind it to do better. And some benchmarks that don't take us, you know, 10 and 20 and 25 years.
As someone who came to Howard University and came through the athletic department, I'm always, my love Howard University athletics hat is never far off of my head. And, you know, I've thought about this issue that you've spoken of. And Dr. Swire, President Swire, you bring up the football team. And the what became the obvious influence and impact that student activism could have on an institution. I brought up Frederick Douglass said, a power concedes nothing without a struggle, never has, never will. It's like you always got to fight for it. So, you know, I'm wondering, you know, I sort of fantasize about something, and that is an effort to be initiated to get our students, and especially our athletes, at these institutions to become more aware and to become more active. One, if they did, they could have the kind of immediate impact on an institution that they had in Missouri. That's one thing. The other thing is, if we would ever collect ourselves enough within the African American community, that we could have the outstanding ball players instead of going to Michigan State and instead of going to UCLA and Stanford to say we're going to a historically black college, I will guarantee you, like Bear Bryant did in Alabama when Sam the Bam Cunningham ran all over them from USC.
Or Kentucky.
He knew, or Kentucky. Kentucky. They knew right away they had to change their policies quick, fast, and in a hurry.
You know, when Western Kentucky, the Hilltoppers, won the national championship, folks said, you know, maybe these black kids can play, you know, and maybe we need to recruit some of them.
And you're talking about a team, an all-black team that won against an all-white Kentucky team that had a dynasty.
Yes, and won the national championship.
Right.
And Rupp said he'll never have a black player.
Yes, he did.
Well, he sort of changed his mind very quickly after he lost the national championship.
Right.
But your point is so important, Rock. It is so important. How do we convince the student athlete to understand not just their role on the campus, but the enormous influence they have? The young people at Missouri, the players at Missouri, obviously figured it out and acted upon it. And I think we really, really need to salute them. The notion of the dumb jock was certainly dispelled by those young people at Missouri.
Yes.
The question becomes then, how do we convince more young student athletes to act? Now, some of the student athletes have begun to understand that the CBS contract to broadcast the Final Four is worth billions of dollars. I think it's $4 or $5 billion.
Yeah.
I may be off a billion or two, but it's an important piece of revenue for the participating institutions.
Right.
They're asking the question, not simply, what about us?
Yeah.
But what about black coaches?
Yeah.
What about black scorers? Look at the scorers table.
Yeah.
What about black referees?
Yeah.
What about black equipment managers?
Yeah.
What about that whole superstructure, that whole superstructure of folk who sup at that table and who do very well? That's powerful.
Yeah.
Now, you know, I'm gonna mention Howard again, and and here we're fortunate. The general counsel of the NCAA happens to be an African American. He also happened to be a Howard graduate, by the way. And he's on the team, if you will, to the extent that he can be, to the extent that he can be a forceful advocate for reform, for reform. But your point about, Rock, I'm of a generation. When I enrolled at Howard, the best athletes of our community were at Grambling. We're at Texas Southern. We're at Southern University. These were the powerhouses. When you had Big House Gaines, when you had Eddie Robinson, coaches, great coaches, by the way. They came before television, if you will. Television comes, the notoriety that television brings, the possibility of a life in the pros, and the riches that brings, and we lost something. Mm-hmm. We lost something. When I applied to Howard in 1960, which is when I applied to Howard in 1960, right. Howard, like Hampton, like Tuskegee, mm-hmm. like Fisk, didn't recruit. Mm-hmm. They didn't recruit.
Right.
They selected. Mm-hmm. They didn't have to recruit.
Sure.
They selected.
Right.
Well, now we have to recruit, and we have sure. to work to get our own.
Right.
And there are some institutions, fortunately Howard and Hampton and a few others, Spelman and Morehouse, that are still mm-hmm. in a position where they're getting the best and the brightest.
Yeah.
And hopefully that will continue. Mm-hmm. But your point, your critical point of how do we organize a setting, a circumstance, where the top student, the top student athlete, the young man who has the offers from Oklahoma, mm-hmm. has the offers from Florida State, says, you know, I can take that talent yeah. elsewhere,
yeah.
on HBCU,
yeah.
I can get a great education. I can make lifelong relationships and contacts. And by the way, if I'm good enough, guess what? Yeah. I'll be in the pros.
Absolutely.
You know,
Absolutely.
I can make it to the pros.
That would be a seismic shift.
Yes.
And what would be perhaps still, as one of the reports mm-hmm. says, it's going to be a century and a half before, you know, there mm-hmm. is equity. Mm-hmm. That would be a seismic shift mm-hmm. that would create mm-hmm. greater fairness mm-hmm. immediately.
Absolutely.
If we could
but
do
most,
that.
Most high school students, because the majority of the nation's K-12 teaching force is white, mm-hmm. are not getting access to information about HBCUs. Mm-hmm. Teachers tend to refer students to institutions that they attend.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look inside inner city schools, 71% of the teaching force is white. If you go outside of inner city schools but stay in urban communities, 91% of the teaching force is white. And the majority of principals are white as well. So there's a tremendous demographic mismatch between K-12 students and the school personnel, teachers and principals who are serving them.
And counselors.
What does this, and counselors. So what does this mean? It means that black students and education professionals rarely hear these statistics, that if you compare a black student who goes to a white institution and a black student who goes to a black institution, the black student going to an HBCU is more likely to graduate in 4 years, more likely to graduate with a higher GPA.
Overwhelmingly so.
And more likely to be accepted to the graduate and professional school of his or her choice
yeah.
compared to the black student that goes to the white institution.
Mm-hmm.
So these are some quantitative indicators
yeah.
that speak to the caliber of the academic experience
mm-hmm.
that black students are gaining at HBCUs
mm-hmm.
and the paucity of that experience that black students are gaining at TWIs.
Yes.
That's a problem
yeah.
because most of the nation's black students are at TWIs.
Yeah.
Most of the nation's post-secondary yeah. black students
yeah.
are at TWIs.
And again, you know, medium portrayal would make you think that these black institutions are also RANs, if you
yes,
if,
yes,
if,
yes.
If you will. When you start to talk about the black college experience and what the student gets at a historically black college as mm-hmm. opposed to what it gets at a white institution, I really want to come back to that for a second, because I think that, you know, I've known this for a while. Many years ago, I joined with Tony Brown in what was Black College Day 1980. Mm-hmm. And I started to learn 35 years ago these statistics about how when a student goes into a black college, his likelihood of graduating with a higher GPA than if he went to a white school is significant. And what people would say, oh, that's because the course curriculum is somehow inferior.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what debunked that theory was in fact that kids who graduated from a black institution were much more likely to be accepted into a white institution
yes.
than the student who
yes.
went to a white institution.
Yes. Yes.
So that proved that theory
Absolutely.
To be wrong.
And there's another piece of that research, a new yeah. generation of research conducted by Bill Spriggs and his colleagues. Bill is on the faculty, Dr. Spriggs, here at Howard University
mm-hmm.
in the economics department, saying that black students who graduate from HBCUs have better long-term earning potential in the labor force than black students who are graduates of white institutions. Now, when I saw the students protesting, it was personal for me. Mm-hmm. I'm a graduate of the University of Virginia and Ohio State University. Mm-hmm. These are institutions that I'm proud to say are my alma maters. But I come from a family of graduates of Howard University and Fisk and other HBCUs.
Right.
And so those students' concerns were not foreign to me.
Mm-hmm.
I experienced many of the same things that those students are talking about now in 2015 in the very early 80s. And that's very distressing, very, very distressing. So for every story those Missouri students have, I have a story as well. I was very intrigued by the newly appointed interim president's comment that as a student at University of Missouri and a law school faculty member at the University of Missouri and an administrator, I think he was undergrad, law school, and an administrator, he said he experienced racism every day in all three capacities. And so it's unacceptable that, you know, the article, we say we're charting a course toward Mars. NASA is talking about Mars. We have, you know, autonomous cars and smartphones, and we are still struggling with this narrative around racist behavior and language in the nation's intellectual capitals across the country. It's embarrassing to the nation, and it's unacceptable given the resources that we have.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys, are you looking to galvanize like-minded thinkers across the country in an effort to make an impact, to grow the opportunity for diversity in at these traditionally white institutions?
One of the statistics that Dr. Fenwick mentioned a moment ago had to do with the fact that there are approximately 3,000, a little bit more than 3,000 post-secondary institutions, colleges and universities in the United States. Of that number, a little less than 30 are led by African Americans. Now, to your question, what I did a number of years ago, I brought together African American presidents of historically white institutions to talk about this issue and related issues. Mm-hmm. Now, the first meeting we held was at O'Hare Airport in Chicago, Illinois. At that time, there were 24.
How long ago was this?
This would have been in 1993.
Okay.
There were 24.
Mm-hmm.
24.
Mm-hmm.
Today, more than a decade later, there are less than 30. So at that level, yeah, there's been very little progress, mm-hmm, as well. However, and by the way, the second meeting we had was held in Washington, D.C. at Howard University. At that time, I was president of Howard, but I was encouraged by my colleagues to keep it up, keep the meetings going.
Yeah.
So we said, okay, I'm no longer president of historically white institution, I'm president of Howard,
mm-hmm,
but I hosted the meeting, we came. The idea was to try to come up with some ways of increasing that number,
right,
because that's a very important number as well.
Mm-hmm. 1%, that's, if my math is right, that's
1%.
1%.
About 1%,
okay.
Yes.
All right.
And so that's one level. Back to your point, bringing folk together is a challenge, but it's worth the effort. I think Dr. Fenwick has been very active in terms of her professional colleagues in doing so. As President Emeritus, I've tried to continue a discussion, a dialogue among folk to consider ways and means of both increasing faculty and increasing within the pipeline the number of African American men and women who should be presidents, should be on that road to chancellor, to being a chancellor, to being a president. At the end of the day, it's leadership. And on campuses, it's the president who leads, the president who sets the tone, the president who gives the signal, if you will, mm-hmm, that this is good and this is where I'm serious about this.
Yeah.
Bringing folk together nationally is again, it's a challenge,
sure,
but it's worth the challenge. But
yeah,
I want to go back to Missouri. It wasn't the black faculty, mm-hmm, at Missouri, and I'm sure they are good people, mm-hmm, hardworking people.
Mm-hmm.
It was the students.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
we have to figure out ways and means of giving, I won't say putting some spine, giving some spine, mm-hmm, to black faculty. If you're one of 10 black faculty members on a major campus,
yeah,
it's very difficult.
Yeah, you got a family,
yeah,
to feed.
You got a family.
You brought up something that to me that is so very critical. When you talk about the lack of teachers that these high school students are hearing from, which I have positioned privately and publicly, that I think aside from a mother and a father, that the third most important role and responsibility that we have in the human experience is that of a teacher. And so I believe all teachers should be paid, I don't care where they are, I believe they should be paid a whole lot more money, and that we should do things that attract teachers. Now, if those white teachers and counselors are advising these black students to go to schools that they're familiar with, that they are most impressed with, because they don't, frankly, have any experience about the HBCUs, it seems like there's another layer here that we're going to have to work on, and work on in a big way, and that is encouraging the African American students who are coming through these colleges to take a hand at teaching.
Absolutely. Well, you know, you're singing the song that a dean of a school of education wants to hear, and I was, there's a two-part response to that. Again, most folk in the mainstream community are unaware of the deep tissue strengths of HBCUs. The deep tissue strength of HBCUs is not their little these little citadels of support. I mean, it takes something for a student and a faculty member to survive and thrive at HBCUs, because they tend to be resource challenged. The great strength is that we have these collectives of these models of intellectual authority that are diverse and impactful. And most faculty at HBCUs, guess what? Earned their terminal degree, whether that was a PhD or a JD or an MD/DDS, at TWIs, at traditionally white institutions, because many HBCUs did not have graduate programs in the breadth of fields. And so you wonder, well, if HBCUs, which are 3% of the nation's schools, colleges and universities, can attract African American and other blacks with PhDs in various fields, and we have fewer resources to do so, why haven't the great state and private institutions that are traditionally white not done so as well, when they have more resources in the past and currently? But that's part A of the problem. Part B of the problem is this tremendous demographic mismatch between the nation's public school students, who are now more than 50% minority for the first time this fall, first time in the history of public schools, this fall the nation became a majority minority school system. The majority of students in the school system, 50.3%, are students of color, mainly African American and Hispanic, and also the majority of students in the public school system, the nation's public school system, are poor. About 50.1% of students are categorized as poor. We do have more work to do in terms of diversifying the teaching force. And one way to do that is to encourage minority students, African American, Hispanic, Latino students, to pursue education as a career. Those students often get a lot of misinformation about the profession of teaching and its attendant professions, becoming a principal or superintendent. There is more work to be done in that.
You know, a couple of Sundays ago, I attended an event in Las Vegas where President Frederick, current president of Howard University, spoke. And in telling the Howard story, part of what he talked about was that the first budget that Obama signed when he put forth when he came into office had fairly significantly cut the funding for Howard University. And he went back to speak to the speaker at the time, who was a Republican individual, and that person actually worked it out where they stopped the cut and either took it back to what it was or maybe gave a little bit more. I am curious, Dr. Swigert, in your tenure as president here, there seems that it's been a bit of a tortured relationship between the president of the university, leading the institution, trying to keep it afloat, trying to keep a strong identity and something for everybody to be proud of, especially the African-American community. And at the same time, having to deal with the whims of Congress. Part of what I remember is what was thought to be the effectiveness of James Cheek in his dealing with Capitol Hill. Now, Dr. Cheek was very clear, was a Republican. And I'd like to see if you could give me some feedback as to what has happened with one administration versus the other.
Sure, let me begin by saying Dr. James Cheek was, in my view, a great president of Howard University.
Yeah.
Much of what you see on campus today was a result of what he built on this campus. School of Business example and so much more. And may he rest in peace. I was very fortunate when I became president of Howard. The chairman of the Senate subcommittee was Arlen Specter.
Okay.
Years back, when I was in Philadelphia as a law professor, I served for a time as a special assistant district attorney when Arlen Specter, Senator Specter, was district attorney for the city of Philadelphia. So we started there.
Yeah.
It was old home week in that regard. On the
it's
House
good to know somebody that knows somebody.
On the House side, the chairman of the Appropriations Subcommittee was Congressman John Edwards of Illinois. Who was a tremendous individual and great friend of the university. The ranking minority member was Lewis Stokes. With Lewis Stokes on the committee.
So you walked into more friendly terrain.
Very, very friendly. And then I had a legislative task force of the Board of Trustees. Well, who was on my legislative task force? Colin Powell, Vernon Jordan, Dick Parsons, and I'll think of the next, I can see him, but I call him Jack Kemp. That was my legislative task force. So I would go to Capitol Hill. I had General Powell on one side, I had Vernon, I had
Jack Kemp.
And Jack Kemp was a tremendous Howard booster, as you probably know. He was just tremendous. Good Republican and very strong for Howard. We'll fast forward a bit because I served for 13 years. I served under two administrations. We fast forward. Now we're looking at the Department of Education. Rod Page, who himself a graduate of Texas Southern, was Secretary of Education. I didn't have to explain HBCUs to Rod Page. Secretary Page understood HBCUs and was a fan of Howard University, a great supporter of Howard University, and a former athlete himself, attended football games and all the rest of it. He was succeeded by Margaret Spellings. Well, Margaret Spellings, Dr. Spellings, also was simpatico with what we were trying to do at the university. So I say all that to say, it was still a challenge, but I was very fortunate in terms of the people who I had to work with on Capitol Hill. The other thing that was, I think, was helpful to me was that when I became president, I shared with Capitol Hill certain benchmarks that I sought to meet. At that time, and this is, and I'll say this publicly if you tell me you won't repeat it.
I won't.
Okay, don't repeat it.
Just us.
When I became president of Howard University, alumni support of the university was 4%. 4%. I said to the Congress, to Senator Specter, to Congressman Stokes, within 2 years, it'll be 20%. Well, folks said that can't be. You can't go from 4 to 20. Well, we did that. I gave him some other benchmarks. And what I did was I tried to meet every one of those benchmarks so you had built up credibility, which is what you had to do. But it was a challenge. But let me go back to another president briefly, if I may. In my view, the individual who built what we now call Howard University was, of course, Mordecai Wyatt Johnson.
Putting those initials there.
Mordecai Wyatt Johnson. If you think we had trouble, and I had trouble, challenges, if you think the current administration has challenges, he had to deal with active segregationists on campus. He had to deal with folk on the Rules Committee who said, you know, segregation now, segregation forever, and we don't care about this colored college up on the hill somewhere. Okay. That's who he had to deal with. He was accused of being a communist. Well, first accused of being a socialist. Then they raised it up to he was a communist. Just one thing after the other. But one of the things that, President Johnson did when he became president, he said, I've inherited an institution. Very, very few of the schools at that time were accredited by national accrediting agencies.
Right.
Before I conclude my tenure, he became president in 1926, he ended in 1960. Mm-hmm. All the schools and colleges at that time were accredited. Mm-hmm. It said, it doesn't, may not sound like a lot, that's a great achievement. Mm-hmm. He also reestablished with Congressman Crampton, after whom Crampton Auditorium is named, and who was a Republican from Michigan, by the way, he established a relationship. And the relationship was, we're going to be an outstanding institution. We're going to maintain fidelity to our mission, which is the education of this nation's black youth. Mm-hmm. We're going to be relevant. We're going to speak to national issues. And therefore, he gave a platform and an environment, in spite of all that was going on around him, he gave a platform and an environment for Thurgood Marshall, for William Henry Hastie, for George E.C. Hayes, all of whom, by the way, were litigated Brown versus Board of Education. He provided that environment in spite of it all. So when I think of President Sir Howard, in my office as president, I had a photo right behind my desk, and it was of Mordecai. Mordecai Y. Johnson, because to me, he's our George Washington, our Abraham Lincoln, and our Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And more people need to know President Johnson, his history, and what he did with all that's going on around him. He didn't bite his tongue. In fact, he was so outspoken sometimes, got a little bit of trouble.
But what, what, you know, as we look at what we have to deal with now and sort of the climate, and not nearly the personal danger of people feeling as if, hey, well, if I don't like what you're saying, you know, I'll come and take your head off. And as you say, those people, and so Mordecai White Johnson dealing with those segregation now,
absolute segregationists.
Forever,
And he didn't retreat.
Yeah.
I mean, he had very courageous, powerful statements around race and access and our place here in the United States.
And he provided a home. He provided a home for folk. You could find comfort at Howard. Howard was a safe harbor for you, which was, again, Washington was a segregated city. He was dealing with a segregated Congress. He had he had some success with President Truman, but his success was would come and go with some of these personalities on Capitol Hill. But he stayed strong. Now, of course, let's not overlook my president during my time at Howard from 1961 to 68, undergrad and law school, was, of course, James Madison Neighbor. Who, you know, again, Rock, I was very fortunate. I saw Mordecai Y. Johnson live and in person. I saw a young Martin Luther King speak on his campus. I saw James Madison Neighbor. He was my president. First authored the first handbook, first textbook on civil rights. Thurgood Marshall lectured at the law school. So, you know, I'm a product of all that. So to me, again, as I said before, we were fortunate. We were very fortunate. But being fortunate is not enough. We've got to get these messages out. And one of the things that this article tries to do is to say, we just can't rest on what we've done. You know, I'm president emeritus. Frankly, I can just sit and be president emeritus. I don't have to speak too much of anything. But it's important that we challenge these institutions. Again, give me a $32 billion endowment. What can I do? Who can I recruit to my campus?
And, some might say, you know, we're at Howard University. What do we have to do with University of Missouri? But Brown was crafted here. Brown was crafted. In our institutional DNA resides the Brown decision. And so we have a moral obligation, an intellectual obligation, to lead and speak to the nation on these issues that are related to race, equity, and educational opportunity.
As the dean, having this kind of knowledge and sensitivity and passion, is it anything that you do or say to those that report to you that you want the experience of the Howard student that comes through the School of Education to be aware of these kinds of sensitivities?
Absolutely. I don't stand apart from my faculty in terms of a consciousness around mm-hmm. race, equity, educational access, and opportunity. Mm-hmm. What I've observed about the School of Education faculty, and also I would extend that to the Howard University faculty, is a deep commitment to resolving and eliminating disparities. Mm-hmm. And so I'm a dean that's like my faculty. Mm-hmm. Through their research, through their policy advocacy, through their community outreach, they're working on these issues. Mm-hmm. That's what has them tethered to Howard University. Mm-hmm. That's why we're able to recruit some black faculty and others from TWIs, because they see Howard University as this fertile ground that President Emeritus Swigert speaks to. Mm-hmm. It's not just a fertile ground for the student who comes. Mm-hmm. It is a fertile ground for the faculty member who's seeking to be in a stream of other scholars mm-hmm. who are deeply devoted to resolving these issues that haunt the nation even still.
And today students are much too often, in my opinion, referred to, and I've been guilty of this myself, mm-hmm. saying that young kids are it's a microwave generation, mm-hmm. and even faster than that. They mm-hmm. want immediate results and don't have the kind of sense of struggle that one's had in the past. As the dean of the School of Education, what do you say about that? What's the mentality of today's students?
The Howard University student, I think, represents other students. I'm certainly going to think that Howard University students stand apart, but I do think they're representative of their peers, too, in many ways.
They stand apart. A greater truth has never been told.
They stand apart and they're representative. Let's just say that. These students are extremely politically savvy. Mm-hmm. Their access to information, mm-hmm. which they sometimes confuse with knowledge, because I always am telling students, what you pull up in Google, that's information.
Yeah.
You generate knowledge through discussion, interaction, teaching, and learning.
Yeah.
But their access to information, their immediate access, mm-hmm. has affected their knowledge base.
Mm-hmm.
And their facility with all things technology is transforming everything. Mm-hmm. This, sparking of movement through social media means I don't have to have a Rock Newman or a Leslie Fenwick or an H. Patrick Swigert lead something, stand out in front and speak.
Yeah.
I can get a million people mm-hmm. to agree with me mm-hmm. and we can do something through a hashtag mm-hmm. and get immediate attention in the media for our issue. So I find them extremely facile.
Mm-hmm.
And at Howard, the commitment to social justice mm-hmm. is palpable. Mm-hmm. These students want to be leaders. Mm-hmm. They want to make a difference. And it's not just a want. They intend to. Let me say it that mm-hmm. way. They intend to make
a difference. So there's a real sense of engagement.
Absolutely.
Rock, if
Absolutely.
I may, I want to go back to something again that Dr. Fenwick has said. I teach a class out at the law school, and one of the things that I try to get the students to understand, although they understand it somewhat intuitively, is this notion of DNA. This is what Howard does. Mm-hmm. This is Howard.
Yeah.
This is why we're viewed as a national institution. This is why we were founded in the nation's capital, mm-hmm. and we were founded on the premise that we would be the leading light. Mm-hmm. When we were founded as part of the Freedmen's Bureau, the notion was Howard would be a center, and it would be spokes would go out both to normal schools and other schools and colleges mm-hmm. with Howard at the center. Being engaged in an issue, whether it's University of Missouri, whether it's faculty, the lack of black faculty on white campuses, if Howard was just Howard, if we're totally insular, mm-hmm. we would not have been the place where Brown versus Board of Education was really mm-hmm. bred
right.
in large
right.
measure.
Mm-hmm.
Because we would have our own.
Yeah, sure.
That's not who we are. Mm-hmm. So when I talk to students, I say to my law students, speak out, be active, because mm-hmm. that's who you are. Mm-hmm. That is your DNA. Mm-hmm. That's part of the dynamic of being here at Howard University.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hearing your report on the mm-hmm. students in terms of what you're dealing with here on the ground right now and the students that are in your sphere of influence mm-hmm. right now, that is very encouraging. As you, Dr. Swigert, put it in a historical perspective, it is a perspective that I try to share with people when they ask me. My wife says that I have a juvenile loyalty and obsession and affection with Howard University. It's like my first love that I never really got over, and I stay in the queue. But to hear you guys, one, in terms of your perspective, and one, the immediacy of now, there's much to be hopeful for. You know, when I read your article in the Washington Post, I simply was not aware that the numbers were as drastic as they are. And what am I talking about? What I'm talking about is if we're 11 or 13% of the population, and we only have educational leaders at the majority of these schools of 4%, there's a lack of equity there. And that you all have taken this on, and when you don't really have to, and that you are sort of at the vanguard of making people aware so that we can have an impact for the good. I start my show always by saying I want to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. You guys are extraordinary. Thank you so
Thank you so much for having us here today. Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
That wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you, and we'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.